After 2001, Blink-182 was in a weird spot. After hitting it big with 1999's Enema of the State and becoming blowable icons with 2001's Take Off Your Pants and Jacket, the band was in this period where they had to first take a break from the tour from the 9/11 attacks, but ultimately would cancel these shows, as founding guitarist and singer Tom DeLonge suffered from a back injury. It was during this time of the break that Tom started to write songs less about girl problems and dick jokes, and more about stuff that explores the apocalypse, conspiracy theories, the government, and anger. Take that and him being influenced by bands like Fugazi, Quicksand, Refused, you have the most hardcore and punk Tom has ever sounded in his whole career.
I've always been a fan of hardcore punk, so when you look at punk rock music, there's like kind of different branches of the tree. The hardcore kids is a much heavier thing. It was almost like living in between fast punk and fast metal, but there'd be these big grindy parts. So what happened after that, though, was this kind of post-hardcore movement where you didn't need to be screaming all the time and you didn't need to be super speedy all the time. You had the melodic stuff from the punk rock kind of that you loved and grew up knowing, but it was done in a much more adult, darker, or more aggressive way. And that really resonated with me. So I instantly was like, well, how do I do that? How do I go from writing really catchy, fast guitarists to something, you know, much more heavy? And the first song on the record was a song called All Systems Go. And that song was the first one that Boxcar Racer wrote. And we said, holy shit, you know, we're really on to something with this. The riff was started out with something that you might think Blink would do, where it's going. It was just this kind of droney thing, but then this fill comes in and it goes. Sunk down into these verses that were like super kind of groovy. That to me was like, okay, this is what really interests me. So what we did was a lot of it revolved around drum sets. We would record the big heavy guitar parts with these big drum sets, you know, and then we come down to the verse where it's quiet. We did this one little mic on a little drum. So it was tiny drums to big drums, tiny guitar to big guitar. So when you listen to the Boxcar Racer record, it's so dynamic.
The rest of 2001 was focused on this side project as more songs were written, and Tom got Blink-182 and former Aquabats drummer Travis Barker the drum on the project due to him being available and him not wanting to pay a session musician. On this time, Travis will mention in his 2015 biography, Can I Say, that he asked Tom if they should use the riffs for our new Blink album. He writes, I honestly thought that Tom had already had a conversation with Mark about this. They were so tight, inseparable. I couldn't imagine Mark didn't know. Then from December 2001 into January 2002, Tom and Travis would record the only album by the side band known as Boxcar Racer. Tom and Travis would use the help of Blink producer Jerry Finn to produce and include collaborations from Jim Armstrong of Branson and Transplants. Now, if you're paying attention, you might notice that we left out one person in the mix. Enter bassist Mark Hoppus. Mark was the only one in the Blink camp not included with Boxcar Racer at all, as Tom didn't want to turn the project into basically the next Blink album. This would sour him and Mark's relationship, as Mark felt betrayed by not being a part of the project, but Mark was able to sing backup vocals on the album closer, Elevator. On that topic and song, Mark would say, "The whole situation suck. But I sang on the track because at the heart of it, Tom and Travis are my friends. I'm sure Tom felt the tension and asked me as an offering. I was glad to have done it, and I was glad that he asked." After the album was finished, Mark and Tom put some of that tension aside to get Blink back and running. As during that time, they would embark on the Pop Disaster Tour with Green Day. Before the tour started, both bands did an interview on MTV promoting it, and the interviewer would bring up Boxcar Racer, asking stuff like, "Does Travis seem better than the other Blink albums, and is Tom the better writer?" And stuff like this would being asked. You can tell by the look on his face, Mark just looked uncomfortable during the whole situation.
During the Pop Disaster Tour with Green Day, the Boxcar Racer album would come out and soon a full band would form. Once again, Mark would be absent as Anthony Celestino taking over bass, with David Kennedy being the band's second guitarist. This also began the era of Tom leaving behind his Fender signature to move towards using Gibson hollow bodies, as he started with his iconic red ES-335. The Boxcar Tour lasted from September and concluded in November. During that time, Travis would be in the band Transplants with Tim Armstrong from Rancid, so anything Blink related would be pushed to next year when they would start production on their next album. With all of
this, I know now. The band would regroup in January and begin work on their next album. They first started recording in a luxury house in Santa Fe. The band would spend the first 90-ish days in the house before moving to Rolling Thunder Studios in San Diego for the rest of their production. During recording, Travis would be on the Transplants tour, so Tom and Mark got more time to record during the year. Half of the year was taken up recording songs and doing a couple of small summer shows to debut some new songs like Go, Obvious, and Feeling This. Along with those small shows, the band would also spend some time with the troops in the Middle East and play shows for them as well. This era once again brought Tom to Gibson with his new signature ES-333 model, which he'd used throughout the entirety of this era. The album was also the start of Blink using different recording techniques like recording each drum individually in Easy Target and having a guest vocalist on all of this. All of this would have Robert Smith of The Cure as a guest vocalist. The band were huge fans of The Cure, so having Robert Smith on the song was an honor. The album took about exactly 280 days to record, with another 8 days to finish mixing the album. Recording a video for what would become the lead single, Feeling This, also getting photos, mini videos done by the artist Scandalous. When coming up for a title, the band had no name for it, so it was always debated. Travis saw it more as a self-titled album, while Mark considered it to be Untitled. Within fans, the album was always called the Untitled album, as it fits more. Finally, the album was released on November 18, 2003, where it was a hit. It debuted at number 3 at Billboard and sold 313,000 copies first week. The album would also be praised by critics, as it showed Blink was more than dick jokes and vulgar comments. Fans, for the most part, loved it, while some felt alienated by the sudden change of Blink going from fun summer times to serious and dark only in the span of 2 years. Now that the album was out, it's time to tour. The band would first start with the Dollar Bill Tour. As the title implies, the band would play small shows for only $1 to get entry. These shows lasted from the 6th of November until the 21st. Then the real Untitled Tour began and started on December 2nd before going into the new year. The tour continued throughout the year, where the band would bring out guest acts which included The Nervous Return, Motion City Soundtrack, Brand New, Gyroscope, Cypher Sale, Taking Back Sunday, Fall Out Boy, The Used, and No Doubt, where them and Blink would share a tour in the summer. The Untitled Tour was the beginning of where the tension between Mark and Tom would return. They would be integrated with the music. The band would play the fastest they ever have, with gigs like Camden and Wembley being some of the fastest the band has ever been recorded. Apart from the tour, the band would release singles and videos for I Miss You, Down, and Always. Also, the many interviews and TV performances were spread out across the year, with the Pepsi Smash performance of I Miss You and The Rock Show being the more known ones. Tour dates in Australia had to be cancelled due to Travis breaking his foot before getting back at it in April. The band would keep on playing until December 16, 2004. This is where the band had their final show in Dublin, Ireland, where the tension was at their worst and the boys were at their fastest. Yes, the whole energy showed that they wanted to get out of there almost ASAP. After the band would play what would have been their final show on December 16th, the band's tension was at the worst at that point. Tom cited how he wanted to take time off from touring and take a break to be more at home with his family, which is understandable. Mark and Tom would never speak, and Tom stopped talking to the band altogether, only speaking to Mark and Travis through his manager. Now this is where the problems in the story come, as there are two sides of the story. Tom's side is how he wanted to take time off from touring and take a break to be more at home with his family, which is understandable. Meanwhile, Mark tells a different story, how Tom wasn't the same. He'd only speak to his manager whenever talked to the boys. He even changed his number so they wouldn't call him. I mean, it was the manager who even told Mark and Travis that Tom was out. And so, in February 2005, Blink would announce that the band was on indefinite hiatus, which, if you don't understand what that means, basically they broke up and the first Blink era was over. So anything Blink had planned, like extra shows and a single for the Untitled track, all of this would feature Robert Smith of The Cure, would be cancelled. The band would move on as Mark and Travis formed Plus 44 and Tom would form Angels and Airwaves, although one last Blink thing would come out. In Halloween 2005, the band, or more like the label, released the Greatest Hits album, which had all the hit songs from 1995-2003. There were two bonus tracks. There was the Only Ones cover, Another Girl on a Planet, which was used for Travis's reality show, Meet the Barkers, and the more known Not Now. The song was an outtake from the Untitled album, but was the most meaningful song from the period. The song is written from the perspective of someone on the verge of death. It's almost poetic, as the final song released by the band would end up being a song about something you love dying. The lyrics of Please Stay Until I'm Gone, I'm Here, Hold On, To Me, I'm Right Here Waiting, is echoed as the chorus. It's in the final part of the song where Mark comes in on backing vocals, almost echoing the feeling that this is the end and everything's gonna be fine.